Hello, my name is Paul Fehlinger, and I am the manager of the Internet and Jurisdiction Project, which is a global multi-stakeholder dialogue project to address the tension between the cross-border nature of the Internet and the patchwork of national jurisdictions. Why did we launch the Internet and Jurisdiction Project? What we see today is a tension between this cross-border transnational nature of the Internet and its services, and basically the vertical structure of our jurisdictional system that is based on the territorial conception, the geographical conception of nation states with distinct borders. However, the Internet is a borderless infrastructure. So the principle of jurisdiction in cross-border situations is rooted in international criminal law. It was a rare issue historically that transborder interactions occurred, and basically, as you know, it was based on either in rem jurisdiction or in personam jurisdiction for a state to assert a law over an event, a person, or assets in a given country. This Westphalian conception of national sovereignty and jurisdiction that exists since the Treaty of Westphalia that ended the religious wars in Europe in 1648 is challenged by the transnational horizontal nature of the Internet. Basically, cyberspace or the collection of different cyberspaces, of shared cross-border online spaces that span across multiple national jurisdictions, form a distinct order on their own, a distinct geography of cyberspace that does not match one and one the physical geography that our modern day legal systems are based on. In a way, those shared cross-border online spaces, we talk about platforms like Facebook, like Twitter, like Google, in a way they form something that could be called digital territories. If you think about it, they have terms of service, so private contracts basically between the platform and the users that specify a lot how interactions on those platforms should actually happen. So in a way, the terms of service of those platforms are the law of those digital territories. The challenge that we are facing today is that the traditional mode of legal cooperation that is based on interstate cooperation through mechanisms like multi-legal assistance treaties, for example, cannot really handle and cope with the transnational nature of those cross-border online spaces and the simultaneous involvement of different jurisdictions. So for instance, if you're living in India, you're an Indian citizen and you're currently traveling, let's say in France, and you want to write on a US-based platform like Facebook that also has headquarters in Ireland to one of your friends in Japan. So, and let's assume someone is insulting someone, and so there's a case of defamation. Under what law, under what jurisdiction then is this case handled? So this transnational nature of cross-border online spaces and the simultaneous involvement of multiple jurisdictions at one time is leading to a sort of overstretch for the current Westphalian system and modes of legal cooperation. What we are seeing is the emergence of different heterogeneous normative orders. On the one hand, as I already said, we have those sort of digital territories, those cross-border online spaces that form horizontal normative orders with their terms of service that span across multiple jurisdictions. On the other hand, we have the patchwork of the different nation states with their distinct laws on what is allowed not only offline in the physical world, but also what is allowed for their citizens when they go online and interact online. So another issue that is a challenge is the extraterritorial extension of sovereignty, because the Internet, as a borderless as it is also very physical. Users are located in a certain country. Operators are incorporated in a certain territory and are under the jurisdiction of this state automatically. Moreover, data in the internet is stored physically in warehouses, so there's a physical location of data where you can apply jurisdiction. Therefore, if you push the analogy or the conception of national sovereignty to the fullest by applying it to the internet, on operators on your soil or on data centers on your soil, for example, this can have extraterritorial impacts on users, on citizens of other states, because they are influenced, they are impacted by the decision of a sovereign nation state, because everything is interconnected. I will give you some examples. When we have a look at the last 1-2 years of high-level cases that basically show this tension and those challenges, let me start with user data. As you might know, one of the most prominent cases concerning the internet and law back in at the end of the 1990s and the early 2000, was the Licra versus Yahoo case in France that was ruled in 2003, basically saying, yeah, although Yahoo is a US-based service, they should not have links to Nazi memorabilia, which are forbidden under French law. So there was another interesting case in France in recent months involving Twitter. And in last year, in autumn 2012, a top three trending topic was the hashtag Un Bon Juif, which means a good Jew. And there were anti-Semitist tweets propagating on Twitter in the French jurisdiction. So the Union of French Jewish Students went to a court and said, basically, we would like to pursue those people in court, and we would like to have their identities. So a Parisian court in January 2013 ordered Twitter not only to reveal the identity of the authors of those racist tweets, but also to implement in the French jurisdiction a notification tool if those instances of hate speech appear again. So Twitter arguing that according to its terms of service, its internal law, it only reacts to US court orders. But this request was not channeled through a conventional MLET, but it was channeled as a direct demand by the Parisian court to Twitter incorporated in the US, although they are also opened offices in Paris in 2013. And Twitter initially appealed the decision, but lost the appeal, and decided a few months ago to reveal the identity of those authors. So this is the problem for, this is a challenge for access to user data. Another important issue area are DNS seizures. So there's a very famous case, the Rojo Director case. This was a Spanish linking sites that offered a link library to sports streams and videos. And a Spanish court actually declared this website as not being illegal. However, this website, Rojo.com, was acquired through a registrar that was based in the US jurisdiction. So this was sufficient for US authorities to seize this domain that was actually declared being not illegal in the Spanish jurisdiction. Moreover, we have another issue area that made high level, that propelled into headline news over the last month, the so-called digital wildfires, the wild spread of hate speech on the internet. The most prolific case, of course, is the Innocence of Muslim video, which was uploaded on YouTube, which is a US-based platform by a US citizen, but created very heavy reactions all over the world, and which led to a lot of requests from different jurisdictions to YouTube to take down the video either directly globally or to via geo IP filtering to block it in their jurisdiction so that it's not accessible anymore. And in some cases, for instance, in Pakistan, a country that has no MLETs with the US, Pakistan blocked the entire YouTube platform and is still blocking it due to one video. So there's a huge challenge of granularity and of how to deal with a viral spread of information on the internet. Moreover, we have the clash between those horizontal terms of service and national laws. One case that is currently discussed in India in front of the High Court is, for instance, proceedings against or hearings of Google and Facebook involving basically the protection of children in the Indian jurisdictions on Google and Facebook, US-based platforms. And those platforms operate under US law, so basically their child protection is influenced by US law on the protection of children, which is incompatible to a certain extent with Indian law. So here you have a very significant example of the clash of those cross-border terms of service and national jurisdictions. So basically what we see today is the emergence of a patchwork of national solutions. As more and more states implement their laws or update their laws to the digital age in the 21st century, they create a body of law that they want to enforce on the internet. So we see a lot the emergence of blocking, of filtering of content, especially the revelations of the US NSA PRISM surveillance, for instance, also enhanced further the notion of data sovereignty, so that servers should be located within the jurisdiction of a given country in order to guarantee the access to user data and also, of course, prevent surveillance or extraterritorial effects, impacts of surveillance in third countries. And also, given cases like Doha Directa, there's a trend towards the renationalization of top-level domains when people suddenly realize that, for instance, registering a domain in .ly, which is a very nice string for especially English language and URLs, is actually the Libyan ccTLD and therefore under Libyan law. So this whole trend basically leads to a situation where on the one hand our national systems are based on this separation of sovereignty, whereas our challenge is to find solutions to manage commons in those shared cross-border online spaces that span across those multiple jurisdictions. What can be done about this? The traditional reaction to this problem, to this challenge, would be to say there's a need for an international treaty to deal with those issues. However, take the example of the Law of the Seas that was negotiated over 40 years, and seas are rather static in terms of their boundaries. So imagine the internet, its rapid evolution, its cross-border nature or a-border nature. Negotiating 40 years a treaty on how jurisdiction applies on the internet appears not to be feasible. Another possibility would be to harmonize laws. However, since the internet is based on the principle of universal access to websites, harmonizing all laws that are related to the internet in all the different countries also appears to be not a feasible solution. So we are at a moment where we have the emergence of potentially incompatible laws in different countries, different procedures, not only in those jurisdictions, but also in terms of those cross-border online spaces, those platforms, how they react to the different demands, requests from jurisdictions. And we are seeing a creeping fragmentation, sort of vertical and horizontal carving up of the internet, as one scholar put it. And this is posing increasingly a challenge. So this is why the Internet and Jurisdiction Project was founded in January 2012 after a series of global consultations that confirmed the need that something needs to be done about this. The Internet and Jurisdiction Project is a global multi-stakeholder dialogue process. That means that it involves actively international organizations, states, the companies, and civil society actors in order, in a dialogue process, to identify the core challenges of the tensions that we are observing all over the world and possible ways forward. The Internet and Jurisdiction Project is based on two pillars. One pillar that might be especially of interest for law students is the Internet and Jurisdiction Observatory that the National Law University in Delhi is also part of. About 25 scholars from all over the world, selected international experts, are supporting the Internet and Jurisdiction team in keeping track of trends. So qualify the tension. We have created a database where we collect all cases in the social science sense. So it can be, of course, judgments by courts, but also in terms of service changes, administrative decisions that are an example of this tension that we are seeing and that we are talking about. And we collect this in one database, and at the end of every month, we produce a newsletter of the top 20 cases that is crowd-ranked by those experts according to the relevancy of the different cases. And this is informing the participants of the ongoing multi-stakeholder dialogue process. And this is the second leg of the Internet and Jurisdiction project, the facilitation of a global multi-stakeholder dialogue process. Itself, this part of the project is based on two different pillars. On the one hand, the Internet and Jurisdiction project participates in public meetings. They can be global, the global United Nations Internet Governance Forum, or regional or national Internet Governance Forums, for example, in Europe, in Russia, or in Australia. Or other events like the Stockholm Internet Freedom Conference or the Freedom Online Coalition meetings. At the same time, on the other track, we are convening a series of meetings around the world, of workshops under Chatham House rules, that bring all those different actor groups, the international organizations, the states, the business, and the civil society actors at one table to discuss how, in a multi-stakeholder framework, one could address those challenges and find solutions to those problems that are currently piling up. As a first outcome, it was confirmed by those actors in those meetings around the world that there is a need for procedural interfaces, for frameworks between states, platforms and operators, and users. Basically, those frameworks should guarantee the interoperability between heterogeneous normative orders by national laws, by terms of service, and guarantee fair process. And this should be a way to address situations not only of normative coherence, where you have a sort of dual incrimination, but also to address the big challenge of normative collisions, where the norms of a nation state and another nation state or a platform that is involved in cross-border online interactions clash. So the different actors expressed their interest to pursue this dialogue on three issue areas, which is the seizure of domain names, the takedown of content on the internet, and the access to user data. And preliminary outcomes of the dialogue process are potential building blocks for such a fair process framework between the different actor groups. So there are six building blocks that are currently explored and that could be part of such a fair process framework, which are authentication. If you are in a situation that you send a request, for instance, to a platform, how does the platform know that the person who sent the request, for instance, the police officer or other people, have the authority to send this request and are really who they say they are, and if there's really the basis that they say they are basing their demand on. There's the question of determination. How does a platform determine if it complies with the request or not? Moreover, there's the issue of transmission. Today, requests to platforms can be transmitted by an array of different means. They can go through the diplomatic pouch where they are flown in planes to the country and redistributed basically through the ministries to the platform again. Or those requests can be based on very informal phone calls or a fax or an email. So there are many, many different ways to channel those requests, and they're not standardized at all today. Then there's the question of traceability. How can you keep track of those requests? How can you guarantee the transparency in those interactions? Moreover, there's the issue of safeguards. How can you make sure that there are safeguards for the user, that there's for instance, something like an appeal process, a right to respond, things like that. And last but not least, the issue of execution. How can you make sure that there are no unintended consequences when implementing requests or when implementing national law on the internet, that there are no transboundary impacts of those decisions, that you respect a certain degree of granularity when you remove content from the internet, and so on and so forth. So basically the feedback from the different stakeholder groups around the world is that there is a desire to further explore the creation of those procedural interfaces and fair process frameworks for digital coexistence of the different normative orders in order to basically maintain a cross-border internet and prevent this creeping fragmentation that is rooted in the incompatibility of the different laws and procedures, as well as the current legal mechanisms to deal with those issues.